Greetings, and welcome to another episode of Lazy Game Reviews Oddware, where I'm looking at odd and unique and forgotten hardware and software, stuff that's obsolete, stuff that nobody remembers, and today is a prime example of that, and that is the Kovox speech thing. And this was recently donated to me by YouTube user Harry Matic. From what I gathered, he actually built this thing and was kind enough to send me one all the way from the UK, so thank you very much, dude. This thing is rad. So what is the Kovox speech thing? Well, this is one of the very first options for IBM-compatible personal computers for getting sound other than that annoying little bleepy PC speaker that everybody hated. It just didn't sound very good. It sounded like garbage. At least in comparison to other computers out there, even much older computers like the Atari 8-bit line and the Commodore 64, and even the VIC-20 sounded miles better. So, there weren't many options. In fact, there weren't any options for other sound devices on the PC. At first, you had things like the IBM's PC Junior, which was at least another option for sound. It gave you three-voice sound, and also the Tandy computers, which took that and cloned it. But if you didn't have one of those computers, you couldn't just go out and buy one of those to make your computer sound like that. But then you had this thing, which is, of course, the Kovox speech thing, and this is, well, it's sort of a sound device. It's really a DAC, a DAC, which is a digital-to-audio converter. It outputs 8-bit mono sound using a resistor ladder and an analog signal output. And if you don't know what a DAC is, it's, well, according to Wikipedia, a DAC converts an abstract finite precision number, usually a fixed point binary number, into a physical quantity, e.g. a voltage or a pressure. Essentially, it takes stuff that's on your computer in digital form and outputs it to something that's in an analog form, like a speaker in this case. And that is what this does. It takes the digital, puts it to analog, and you can just plug it straight in to any kind of speaker. I'm just going to put up a picture here of kind of what it looks like inside. Really simple, just a lot of resistors. Yeah, that's pretty much it. It's just the most basic DAC you can think of. Now, theoretically, this thing can actually support any sampling rate, but usually you were restricted to something like 8 or 12 kilohertz, and this was just because of the LPT port, the LPT1 or the parallel port that was used to hook this thing up, which is this right here. This is the exact same thing that is used on your printer, at least older printers before USB was around. So it was restricted by that. It was also very restricted because it was demanding on the CPU, supposedly the timer interrupt to play music and things like that, because there was no DMA, no direct memory access available to this thing, so it was really restricted by that. So it had its limitations, but it was at least a big step up from the PC speaker. I think just about anything would be. This was actually quite big. So, yeah. Introduced in 1986, or around that time, I read conflicting stories about this by Kovox Incorporated in Eugene, Oregon, and it retailed for about $70 to $80, depending on when and where you bought it. The thing is, it was marketed originally as part of a voice synthesis and recognition system, but of course it also did music and sound and a bunch of other stuff. This, I don't think does, well, it doesn't actually do any of the voice recognition stuff. But it was all made from cheap parts. It was a very simple design. In fact, it was so simple and used such standard parts that could be bought just about anywhere that a lot of do-it-yourselfer guys and hobbyists just decided to make their own, like this one here, designed and created and built and whatever by Harry Matic. The thing is, it just required very precise resistors. Otherwise, you'd get some distortion. I haven't noticed any problems like that here. I mean, you know, as long as you knew what you're doing, it's fine. And, like I said, it's a really simple design inside. Now, there were also other variations, like those with amps built in. So, you know, normally you would have to have your own external amplifier to actually get the sound any louder. This doesn't have that. There were also some with microphones, like the Kovox Voice Master. That could also modify your voice and do some cool stuff like that for distortion and things. Which sounds kind of fun, but this doesn't do it. And there were some with stereo output, this instead of just mono. And then some that actually had printer forwarding, you know, an extra printer port in the back. You could plug your printer in here and plug this into the parallel, and it was fine. You wouldn't have to take up your parallel port like that. Yeah, what else was I going to mention? Oh, yeah, there was another one that was really, really popular. It was the Disney Sound Source. I'm going to put up a picture of that here. This was really just about the same exact thing as the speech thing, except it had the printer forwarding and everything on the back. And it also had a built-in amplifier and speaker and volume control, which was kind of nice. I guess you didn't have to get your own speakers if you didn't have speakers. And it also had a little bit of extra programming required to access the DAC in the thing, which made it kind of incompatible with the Kovacs speech thing and previous games made for that. So it was kind of restricted to Disney products and a few other things like Wolfenstein 3D, which kind of made it confusing if you're looking for games for the speech thing, because the Disney Sound Source is basically the same, but the games don't necessarily work with the speech thing. And then you have games like, here we have Mantis, and it mentions the Kovacs being an optional sound device here. It just says Kovacs, though. And even if you look on Mobi Games, this is listed under speech thing compatible games, but it's not. That actually means Kovacs Sound Master. The Sound Master was a totally different thing. Basically, it was a speech thing and a couple of other things, I think, on one card, like an ISA card. It wasn't a parallel port device, so it doesn't work with parallel port devices. That's really confusing. There were quite a few games made for the Sound Master. SimCity is another one of those that works with the Sound Master, but it does not work with a speech thing, at least not for me. So it's really kind of confusing to find out what actually works with this friggin' thing. But whatever. I have found a few things, which I'm going to show here in a minute. First, I'm going to show you how, of course, it actually hooks up to the computer. And this is as simple as it gets. You take the speech thing, you plug it into the printer port, the parallel port, and then you take your speaker system and hook it right in, and you're ready to go. There aren't any drivers needed. There's no extra setup needed, no modifying of configsys or autoexec.bat, nothing like that. As long as the game itself is configured for the Kovacs speech thing, it's ready to go. So, all right, let's go ahead and take a look at some stuff that it does, which is awesome. All right, so we've got the Kovacs speech thing hooked up here to the NCR COM 10386, and I'm going to try one game here, which is probably about the best implementation of the Kovacs speech thing that I have heard, at least for overall gaming. There's other programs we'll get to later, but this is right here is going to be Pinball Fantasies, the game by Digital Illusions. So, yeah, here we go. Alright, so as you can hear, it sounds friggin' awesome. I mean, it's digitized music, and it's basically playing mod files right here, but it can also do sound effects. I've heard a lot of people say this thing doesn't do sound effects. I don't know what they're talking about, because it does. So, let's just play a pinball table here. Thank you. really hear the flippers, but they do make sound. Of course, you have that. Alright, I'm gonna show one more table here. Oh, I love this music here too. That classic mod sound. Yeah, it's very similar to what you'd hear on well, really, a lot of later games that use the Sound Blaster, and even a little bit of the Amiga and such. And, you know, it's classic mod stuff, which is awesome. I love that kind of music, you know, samples and everything. Okay, well, apparently I'm sucking at this table right now, so I think we'll just leave it there. So we have another game, really one of the only other games that I have that has support for the speech thing that sounds halfway decent, I guess, is, coming up right here. It's 688 Attack Sub. Which is kind of a very niche product game. Sub simulators aren't exactly my thing, but, you know, it does have some implementation of this. Yeah, and you can see there we're picking Kovac's sound. Example of not the greatest implementation of the Kovac speech thing that I've heard, and really that's, I think, it. The rest of the game just has, like, you know, PC speaker noise, which is not anything to really be excited about. So, yeah, it's, yeah, I mean, that's just PC speaker stuff. I don't know if there's some noise from or sound from the Kovac later on. I haven't played this game enough to really know. But, you know, I have it in my collection. I like the box. The box looks cool. Anyways, let's see. And I've got one other one to try out here. And that is going to be Wolfenstein 3D. that's just because I want to show you kind of what happens when you try to do something that's made for another LPT1 or printer port DAC. And that Wolfenstein 3D is a good example of that, because it's actually made for the Disney Sound Source, which, you know, like I said earlier, is essentially the same exact thing as the Kovacs speech thing. It even detects the sound source right here, you know, as being here on the system. Oh, yeah, you got a sound source. So, you think I should be able to use it, since it detects it, and it's essentially the same hardware, right? Well, it's not exactly that simple. Okay, so we have it chosen here for digitized sound. Basically, this, from what I've seen on videos on YouTube and stuff, it pretty much is the screaming and the gunshots and the doors opening and stuff like that. I have everything else turned off, so we just have the sound source chosen. Alright, let's just play here. I have the volume all the way turned up, and it's, yeah, there's nothing. There's no gunshot noises, there's no doors, no screaming Nazi sounds, nothing. So, I don't really know what the deal is about the Disney Sound Source not necessarily being compatible with Kovacs stuff. I thought it was. Like, you know, like, I'd heard the Disney Sound Source didn't exactly work with some Kovacs programs, but yet you could run Disney stuff on the Kovacs? I don't know. I'm just going to say that they're not really compatible. Let's just go with that. Which is kind of unfortunate, because now I have to have a friggin' Disney Sound Source to try this out. Hey, Nazi, where you at? Oh. Alright, so, that's all for the games. I don't really have anything else that uses this thing. I'm sure there's a few more. There are. Surprisingly, most of the things, most of the games that use the speech thing seem to come out in the mid-90s. Which is kind of weird, because this thing came out like 10 years earlier. So, yeah, I don't know if that maybe had to do with the whole demo scene taking note of it at that time, which is what I'm about to show here. The demo scene did some really cool stuff with it. This is just going to be Inertia Player here, which is one of those tracker kind of programs. And they could take advantage of the Kovacs speech thing and play some really cool stuff through modules, which is kind of what we heard in Pinball Fantasies. Well, that's exactly what we heard in Pinball Fantasies. Which in this case is at 12 kilohertz, so it's kind of sounds a little bit muffled. It's kind of on the lower spectrum of audio or whatever, so not really. It kind of sounds like the treble is turned all the way down, but I assure you it's not. That's just how this thing outputs audio. So, anyways, here we go. Thank you. Okay, so that's pretty much all I'm going to show of the Kovacs speech thing. And I think it's awesome. I just wish there were more games that took advantage of it. There seem to be maybe a dozen or so that I can find that are actually confirmed as using this thing, this Kovacs speech thing in particular. A lot of the others that are on lists I see are for the Kovacs Sound Master or the Disney Sound Source. I've heard that a lot of the reason that this wasn't used in many more games is because of its lack of DMA, it didn't utilize any DMA at all. So it had to use extra processing power in order to pump out the sound on this thing, since it was going through the printer port and everything. But you saw in Pinball Fantasies, it seemed to work just fine. And I've also seen it work in Wolfenstein 3D, so maybe it just was harder to do, or I don't know. It also, of course, had to do with the Sound Blaster and the Ad-Lib really, really gaining popularity after, you know, about 2 years after the Kovacs came around, and maybe Kovacs just didn't approach as many developers to use it. I know that's really how the Ad-Lib caught on. It was publishers and developers like Sierra Online and Accolade that were really approached by Ad-Lib in order to say, hey, put this crap in your games. So they sold cards because the game supported it. But maybe that's, whatever happened. I don't really know. I just wish there were more things that use the Kovacs, because I like it. It's really cool sounding. Yeah, it sounds like a really, really low-end Sound Blaster or something. So, anyways, so that's that. That's pretty much it. I don't have anything else on here that I can think of. So, alright. Well, thanks for watching this edition of Lazy Game Reviews Oddware. But anyways, thanks for watching. See you next time.